HarperCollins and Harper Audio present All That Heaven Allows, a biography of Rock Hudson, by Mark Griffin, performed by Jeremy Arthur. Author's note. It was just the way things were, an 89-year-old actress told me. In Hollywood, back in Rock Hudson's day, you were expected to keep secrets, just as you were expected to learn your lines. Nobody said anything to you, but it was all understood. This is how the game is played. During our interview, Hudson's former co-star expressed all of this rather matter-of-factly and even punctuated her remarks with a shrug. The detached tone was unsettling, given the fact that we had been discussing the code of silence that existed in Hollywood during that period of American cinema, now longingly referred to as the Golden Age. It's true that era was responsible for some of the finest films ever made, but it was also a time when gays were forced to play straight, studio executives passed starlets around like hors d'oeuvres, and casting couches of every persuasion were constantly occupied. In those days, a major studio might take a chance on an aspiring actor with no experience, if he came equipped with the kind of chiseled features the camera loved. The new recruit would be placed under contract and rigorously groomed for stardom. Eventually, this would pay off in the form of fan adulation and magazine covers, the silver lining side of the deal, in other words. But all too often, there were strings attached. Sadly, studio moguls and other power brokers often made demands on young hopefuls that went far beyond having their teeth capped or their noses fixed. It was understood that if a freshman contract player succumbed to the sexual advances of an agent, producer, or head of production, or in some cases all three, their star would rise more rapidly and shine more brightly than if they resisted. Typically, an actor who was uncooperative or outspoken would eventually see their screen career relegated to the B-movie junk heap before sliding headlong into oblivion. From our politically correct perspective, this scenario is so off the charts egregious that it's hard to reconcile the fact that such behavior was once considered business as usual in Hollywood. In these more enlightened times, most people readily assumed that such sexually exploitative business practices had long ago gone the way of silent movies. That is, until the day in 2017 when Oscar-winning producer Harvey Weinstein was fired from his own multimedia company. More than 80 women, including several well-known actresses, accused Weinstein of rape and sexual assault. Immediately following these allegations, scores of other high-profile actors, directors, and media professionals faced accusations of sexual misconduct. While tallying up the alleged abuses, many journalists took the opportunity to remind the public that although these revelations were genuinely disturbing, this type of exploitation had always existed in Hollywood. One of the names invoked as an example of a serial predator was that of the agent Henry Wilson, who represented a stable of all-American heartthrobs that included his most successful client, Rock Hudson. "If you want to get into films, I can help you," Wilson told countless young men, eager to establish themselves in the industry. Once Wilson's latest discovery had been signed, the agent would do everything possible to help launch his career, though the support came at an especially high price. Everybody who went with him had to sexually express himself to Henry, Tony Curtis told Wilson's biographer. In light of the Weinstein scandal and the many firings and resignations that followed, Henry Wilson's notorious brand of star-making seems deserving of its own hashtag. Even so, it's important to remember that Wilson was commodifying his clients in an age before social media movements and in a place where open secrets seemed to flourish. This is the way things were in Rock Hudson's day, and perhaps better than anyone, he understood how the game was played. Introduction. On the second day of October in 1985, there was no shortage of newsworthy events happening around the globe. Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev had made his first trip abroad. An Israeli air raid on PLO headquarters had killed 68 people. In southwest Sudan, a train carrying famine relief supplies had derailed. While all of these stories warranted international coverage, they would be bumped off the front pages by another headline, the death of a movie star. Rock Hudson, who had appeared in over 60 feature films and defined all-American manhood for an entire generation, had died of AIDS-related causes at the age of 59. On television, images of Hudson saturated not only the likes of Good Morning America and Entertainment Tonight, but all of the network news broadcasts. The tributes included glimpses of Rock in his matinee idol prime, punching out James Dean in Giant, making out with Doris Day in Pillow Talk. These classic clips were intercut with footage of Hudson at a press conference just 3 months earlier, when he reunited with Day to publicize her new cable series, where Rock was almost unrecognizable, gaunt, glassy-eyed, and disheveled. Although Hudson had been the most photographed actor of his generation, it would be these heartbreaking final images of him, looking ravaged and cadaverous, that would remain lodged in the collective consciousness. Following his appearance with Day, Hudson would not be seen again publicly, although his mystery illness would continue to be a major story worldwide. After Rock was admitted to a Paris hospital, the official word was that he was being treated for fatigue and general malaise, though gossip columns and insider exclusives said otherwise. Finally, after weeks of unconfirmed rumors and tabloid innuendo, Rock's French publicist, Yanou Kalar, would tell reporters gathered in front of the American Hospital of Paris, "Mr. Rock Hudson has acquired immune deficiency syndrome." The announcement that Rock Hudson had AIDS and the presumptive gay outing that accompanied it were so shocking, if not to his show business colleagues, then at least to unsuspecting housewives in Peoria, that coverage of his last days seemed to obliterate everything that had come before. When a gravely ill Hudson flew back to America in a chartered 747, this was anything but a happy homecoming. It was clear that Rock had come home to die. In just a matter of weeks, a tragic and untimely death would overtake a rare and extraordinary life. Symbolic of this was the sight of dozens of photographers, first encircling, then engulfing the unmarked van carrying Hudson's lifeless body away from his Coldwater Canyon home. Rumor had it that an American tabloid was offering six figures to anyone who could produce a close-up photo of Rock Hudson's corpse. Such was the fate of an individual who had valued his privacy above all else. In 1972, Rock had been appalled by the media barrage that had accompanied the funeral of his close friend, the actress Marilyn Maxwell. After that experience, Hudson told his then-companion, Tom Clark, that when his own time arrived, the send-off should be quiet and dignified. No three-ring circuses allowed. In the end, he almost got his wish. Although Rock's memorial service would be attended by such celebrity friends as Elizabeth Taylor, Carol Burnett, and Angie Dickinson, every attempt was made to keep the event low-key and respectful. Despite the good intentions, Myra Hall, a neighbor of Hudson's, charged members of the press $300 each to temporarily take up residence on her lawn. Throughout the proceedings, a helicopter hovered over Hudson's yard, as a videographer did his best to capture footage of the memorial. As publicist Roger Jones once said of his most famous client, "He is the center of the storm, dead or alive." Though given the incredible circumstances, how could the death of Rock Hudson be anything less than a high-profile global event? It represented so much. First, there was the passing of a beloved movie icon, one who had appeared in his first film when he was 23, his last as he was nearing 60. Millions of people had watched Hudson grow up before their eyes, and moviegoers came to feel that Rock belonged to them. From the beginning, they had responded to what director Douglas Sirk had described as Hudson's straight goodness of heart and uncomplicated directness. The actor's death signaled another important passing, the metaphoric demise of the Hollywood studio system, which in its heyday had brilliantly manufactured and marketed Rock Hudson. By 1985, it was painfully clear that the kind of stardust and glitter that had enveloped the careers of Hudson and his contemporaries had gone the way of the neighborhood bijou. Universal, the studio that had produced some of Rock's finest melodramas, like Written on the Wind and The Tarnished Angels, had now segued to Halloween 3, Season of the Witch. For most screen stars, achieving pop culture immortality and closing the book on Hollywood's golden age would be enough of a legacy. But Rock Hudson would transcend mere celebrity by becoming the poster boy for a global pandemic. With the disclosure that Hudson had AIDS and not anorexia nervosa, as had been rumored, his own physician, Dr. Michael Gottlieb, would describe Rock as the single most influential AIDS patient ever. Although AIDS had been identified several years earlier, President Ronald Reagan seemed not to grasp how significant the epidemic was. "He accepted it like it was measles, and it would go away," said Brigadier General John Hutton, a White House physician. This kind of head-in-the-sand indifference would result in the Reagan administration being widely criticized for its non-responsiveness to the crisis. That is, until Rock Hudson, a friend of both Ronald and Nancy Reagan, told the world that he was battling the disease. Suddenly, from the White House to Frank's Diner in Kenosha, everyone knew someone who had AIDS. If Rock Hudson can have it, nice people can have it. "It's just a disease, not a moral affliction," said William F. Hoffman, who wrote As Is, one of the first plays to focus on the epidemic. Ironically, having the disease would turn Rock Hudson, silver screen hero, into a real-life hero. And although it had been implied rather than stated, Hudson's coming out, such as it was, had made him the most recognizable gay person on the planet, or bisexual, depending on who you talk to. Even if Hudson's gay admission had been an involuntary one, the New York Times noted that the actor had now been recast in his most paradoxical role, that of a model for other gay men. The fact that rugged, red-blooded Rock Hudson, who had been butch enough to share the screen with John Wayne in The Undefeated, also happened to be homosexual, instantly shattered stereotypes and challenged people's perceptions of what gay meant. In a few short months, the public had been jolted by one Rock Hudson bombshell after another. If all of the shocking revelations, conflicting accounts, and attempts at concealing the truth were unsettling to even diehard members of his fan base, this was Rock's reality. In a sense, the dramatic events playing out on the world stage were a magnification of daily life at the castle, as Hudson's sprawling Beverly Hills home was known. While it had provided the backdrop for many A-list Hollywood parties, the castle was also the setting for some especially contentious court intrigue. As Hudson's health began to fail, there would be an intense power struggle among the members of his inner circle. At times, the plots and counterplots that unfolded were so intricate and intertwining that one former staffer would describe the atmosphere as Shakespeare for Queens. None of Hudson's trusted advisors seemed to trust one another. Old flames found themselves cohabitating with new loves. Close friends became bitter enemies, as some damning accusations were made. Ross Hunter, who had produced several Rock Hudson blockbusters, including Pillow Talk, had remained close to the star he had helped create. When Hudson began declining rapidly, both physically and mentally, a concerned Hunter phoned actor George Nader and his partner Mark Miller. As Hudson's closest friends and caretakers, didn't they know that the whole town was talking? If not, the producer would oblige them by repeating one of the more incendiary rumors circulating throughout the Hollywood community. "I hear Rock's being drugged by staff," Hunter told Nader. After recovering from the shock, Nader and Miller, who had befriended Hudson more than 30 years earlier, were outraged. "Queens will make anything up," Nader wrote in his journal. Regarding Rock being drugged by staff at the castle, it was so ridiculous that it was funny. Their little lie is ludicrous and libelous at the same time. Since Rock had returned home, there was no denying that life behind the walls of the castle had become increasingly surreal. Tom Clark, a Hollywood press agent and Rock's former companion, had been summoned back to the castle after having been banished a few years earlier. Clark would now be living under the same roof with Mark Christian, a another of Rock's former boyfriends. Although Christian had been asked to leave the house, he chose to remain. An already tense household became even more strained. As Tom Clark had once been a stabilizing and supportive presence in Hudson's life, many friends readily welcomed his return, feeling that if anyone could bring Rock some comfort at the end of his life, it would be Clark. But by the mid-80s, Clark's alcoholism had progressed to such a degree that his once clear-eyed judgment had been significantly impaired. Tom Clark has turned Rock's last days into an obscene circus of a publicist's wet dream, George Nader bitterly noted. If celebrity well-wishers like Elizabeth Taylor and Roddy McDowell were welcomed in, some family members claimed that they were shut out. "I was kept out of the loop because the entourage took over my brother's life," says Hudson's adoptive sister, Alice Shearer Ware, who believes that Miller and Nader hindered her attempts to communicate with Rock. "They didn't want me to be acknowledged as any living relative. I was used, lied to, threatened, and abused by them, to the point that I backed away." Though the intimidation tactics that Ware described didn't stop her from suing her brother's estate, the suit filed by Ware a year after Rock's death alleged that he had been unduly influenced by associates when he excluded her from his will. Ware also claimed that some of Hudson's intimates had impeded her efforts to write or telephone her brother and forced him into a lifestyle contrary to his traditional upbringing. Ware's lawsuit had been preceded by another, which was explosive, endlessly debated, and groundbreaking. Only a month after Hudson's death, Mark Christian, who claimed that he had been intimately involved with Rock for 3 years, filed a $10 million lawsuit against Hudson's estate. The 32-year-old Christian maintained that although Hudson had been diagnosed with AIDS in June of 1984, the actor withheld this information from him, and they continued having unprotected sex for a period of 8 months. Hudson's AIDS admission had, for the most part, garnered Rock much heartfelt public sympathy. The 45,000 letters of support he had received in the last months of his life were a testament to this. However, Christian's lawsuit made no bones about it. If anybody was entitled to sympathy, it was the wronged lover and not the morally bankrupt movie star. "If you have AIDS and continue to have sex with someone as if nothing is wrong, I see it as like attempted murder," Christian told an interviewer. Was it possible that the same Rock Hudson who was held in the highest possible esteem by his co-workers, friends, and relatives had been capable of exposing a partner to a potentially deadly disease in exchange for sexual gratification? If Christian's allegations were true, Hudson's betrayal was unconscionable. 4 years would pass before a jury would reach a decision in the Mark Christian case. In the meantime, even more controversy erupted with the publication of a memoir entitled My Husband Rock Hudson. Phyllis Gates, who had been married to Hudson from 1955 to 1958, claimed that Rock and his omnipresent agent, Henry Wilson, had ruthlessly manipulated her into participating in a sham marriage. Gates, who had been Wilson's secretary, would contend that she had been unwittingly used as a pawn to silence the rumors about Hudson's homosexual proclivities while keeping scandal sheets like Confidential at bay. In her book, Gates laid all of the blame for the disintegration of her marriage on Hudson. If Rock's gay predilections were common knowledge even among Hollywood's extras and bit players, Gates had somehow missed this. In a not-so-surprising revelation, she described Hudson's lovemaking as routine and perfunctory. Gates then proceeded to take her deceased ex-husband to task for his dark moods, uncontrollable temper, male chauvinist tendencies, and a strain of jealousy in his nature. What's more, she recalled that Hudson didn't like to brush his teeth because he found the routine boring. In 2 years, Rock Hudson had morphed from movie icon to gay icon to the face of AIDS. Somehow, even after his death, the reinvention continued. Only now, if Mark Christian were to be believed, Hudson was no longer a victim.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.